Hello guys, welcome back. I do hate cutting these songs short. I'm having so much fun playing jazz on stream, but we're back. Another best of one. We're on schedule, we're on time, and we're cracking through the games through WePlay Season 3. We're still in the CIS group stage. Tornado.RoX taking on Team Spirit in this best of one, and with a draft taking a place, I can welcome my co-caster, Nahaz. You're digging the Coltrane?
I am digging the Coltrane. This is what happens when you embrace the old man cast, man. Play some of the classics. You gotta love that stuff. But this should be a really good one. I'm looking forward to this game. Tornado.RoX, or I believe they've been going by Fantastic Five in some of the recent games. They've recently took a game off Liquid. They took a game off Na'Vi. This is a team that can play with just about anybody. And again, we're gonna see that Oracle pick early on. Team Spirit departing a little bit from the drafting formula that's worked recently. I believe they only have one game on Earth Spirit this patch, so this is going to be something a little bit new from them. Maybe they saw it work so well for Empire in the previous game, and they're going to try it out themselves. 10 seconds
remaining. Let's see how they do with it. I mean, Goblack has been playing a funky few heroes. We saw him in the Vengeful Spirit earlier on today. That Aghanim Scepter for like 23 minutes was insane. But there you go, you were talking about this previously, the Invoker pick, the Iceberg hero in the first phase, just ensuring him a good laning stage, and...
Well, does it though?
This is the thing, against OD, you know, a week and a half ago even, maybe even just a week ago, we'd be saying, oh, OD just crushes this lane straight up, but with the transition away from Alacrity into the Forge Spirits, and the fact that OD needs 2 Arcane Orb hits to kill a Forge Spirit in the early stages, Invoker can actually last hit reasonably well and control the lane. And it always comes down to support rotation. So in a vacuum 1v1, Invoker does decently against OD. It's not like a straight-up crushing matchup. OD is still slightly favored with, you know, an Astral forcing Invoker out of last-hitting, well, reality, basically, not able to hit creeps. It still comes down to what the rest of the team can do to upset that kind of status quo at the mid lane.
Absolutely. Look, I agree completely with the analysis that you've Radiant just given. All right. The only thing that I would add into the mix is I think you've always got to ask who loses more if they get ganked early on. And I feel like this is a laning matchup that if OD gets ganked early on, he can still at least do something in the lane. If Invoker gets behind OD,
yeah,
I think he can be just in such a world of trouble. That's what I worry about. And that's really why I like this first phase OD pick. We pointed out in the last Spirit game that we did, this is now 18 out of 21 drafts that Spirit has picked Iceberg's hero in the first phase, and it's almost always been OD, Zeus, or Invoker. So by picking OD as Rox here, you almost guarantee that you're going to be able to lane him against Invoker or Zeus. That's a matchup that they're really looking for.
Well, this fourth ban, Rox, what are you looking for? Enchantress taken out. Don't want to be dealing with the nasty little Bambi jumping around. Radiant, they go with the Faceless Void OD combo. Oh, goodness.
And boy, we're going to see that VS again that Goblack played so well in that previous match. And we saw, again, Rox, I think, certainly a step up in terms of what they're able to do, how well they're able to coordinate from Team Spirit's last opponent. But that 22, 23-minute ags on the Goblack VS was just... It was one of those things that you're like, okay, the game is over.
It was like unprecedented levels of farm, honestly, on the Vengeful Spirit. It was crazy. Crazy amounts of stuff. Well, remaining. With Rox securing their offlaner, their mid laner between OD and Void, still looking for that secondary remaining. Support. Now, Oracle, a little more static than others, likes to be in lane, throwing out Fortress End, stacking and pulling and getting to that level 6. Does have some kill power between them, but with the Gyro banned out, you don't have one of those aggressive heroes to run towards you, and I kind of feel Juggernaut, with the wave of kind of popularity he had, has waned a little bit now, and people seem a little more timid about picking him, but I'm not sure why.
Well, I think it's just a little bit more... teams are getting a little bit better in terms of being able to counter the early pushes, and I think the laning meta has really stabilized a lot. Teams understand now what strong lane compositions look like in 6-8-6, and so just because of those two things alone, I think Juggernaut loses a little bit of his value. He's still a strong hero, though.
Let's see where they go on Queen of Pain.
Yeah, this has been a staple for them, and you're probably actually going to see BZZ on the Queen of Pain. I believe they're 7-3 with BZZ on Quap this patch, so this is probably going to be a safe lane Queen of Pain.
All right, then. Interesting. It's been a while. It's been a while since I've had that. Queen of Pain, go rush into the Orchid if you can. And also going to be bullying out this offlaner for Team Spirit, because heroes that are left... And no Beastmaster, no Brood, remaining. None of these nasty little devils. You can still think about the Nyx Assassin, and that's probably what you look to aim for remaining. Against OD, Queen of Pain. That yeah. Nyx is huge here, if you can pick that up.
I completely agree. You were calling for that in our last match, and I was a little bit nervous picking Nyx into such a teamfight heavy lineup, but I think Nyx, he counters your one and two position cores so hard in this matchup that he's a really good pick, and you've got your offlane pick still free.
Team Spirit, Afterlife, what's your plan? Goblack whispering in his ear the sweet nothings. Pick the Ursa, pick the little bear.
Oh my lord. Okay, all right, well, you were talking about it, man. I was, in the last game that we cast with Spirit this morning, I was talking about how they've gone a little bit more conventional with their picks for Ramses. They've really tried to make him a little bit more stable to complement Iceberg's playmaking style, but they're going to go back to that aggression that's worked for them. They're going to put Ramses on the carry Ursa, and they're just going to look to claw people's faces off.
Yeah, well, with that enrage, walking up to an Like we used to see Ursa picked up against Gyro. Liquid started doing it back at... I guess just before the defense grand finals, where they were just running at people, jumping on the gyro and making sure that he took no damage because of enrage. Same kind of story against an OD and a Queen of Pain. Not going to feel...
Yeah, but you look at... Okay, here's the reason. As much as I, like, the inner fanboy in me, like, loves this pick, and I think it could be really exciting, the analyst in me looks at Tornado's lineup, and every single one of the four heroes has a tool that can deal with Ursa. He can get imprisoned, he can get Chrono, Void can time walk away, Queen of Pain can blink away, Oracle can root him, he can false promise somebody, Queen of Pain can slow him. Ursa just, he has a lot of tools arrayed against him in this matchup.
Well, Tornado.RoX, final support hero left. Remaining. What do you want to go for? It's a Lich, nothing active, actually going for more passive play. Team pick.
And Lich gives you lane control. Lich does have that Chrono Chain Frost combo working in his favor at this point, but I think it's a recognition that Team Spirit are going to have to force a little bit of tempo, and Tornado has the kind of lineup that they're perfectly comfortable letting the enemy team come to them. I actually kind of hate Lich as a hero, I'm going to be honest, but if there were a situation where you want to pick a support on the more defensive side, I don't have a problem with it here.
I kind of feel like, you know, you mentioned the Chain Frost and Chrono. I kind of feel like they've picked Lich here for the Ice Armor, honestly, just against this Ursa.
Oh, yeah.
The Ice Armor's going to be massive.
No, and when you talk, we talked about it earlier, right, that they have so many tools to kite the Ursa. This just goes right along with that.
For sure. Team Spirit, what's your plan, buddies? Earth Spirit hasn't seen the light of day in the three-roll offlane spot that often recently, more used as the roaming support to get up in the face of the mid lane hero and try and give you that early leverage, especially during the laning stage. So I think offlaner, and with the Nyx still out there, I struggle to find a reason not to pick Nyx Assassin. Because you need stuns, you need someone who can go and hunt people down to give vision and catch people out. You need that mana burn against the OD and the Queen of Pain. And even if you have a rough lane against the Quap Oracle up at top, you just buy an Iron Talon. Mag has done it a bunch of times. Iron Talon, go back into the jungle, farm up to level 6, get a Midas, and then you transition into your Blink and whatnot. But maybe you want someone that can maybe move off the offlane and help the Venge Earth Spirit towards the mid. Because it's always that game of balancing the odds, right? If Team Spirit send Earth Spirit mid, Tornado send the Oracle mid. If Spirit send the Venge mid, Rox send the Lich mid. And it just keeps dogpiling on. One extra hero, one extra hero. But it's going to be the Nyx Assassin. He definitely can help occasionally, maybe with a nice rune spawning up at the top lane for them. But I like this draft from Spirit. But how much of a clock are they on, do you think? Have I lost Nahas? Does he rip? Oh, he's having slight technical issues. Okay. He's not dead, guys. He's fine. He's an old man, but he's still alive. Don't worry. He'll be fine. But I kind of feel Team Spirits, the regular clock we kind of look at for these lineups that want to play aggressive early is like 25 to 35 minutes. You want to go and take the base by then. It's not the same kind of ticking time bomb for them. It's more of the fact they need this Ursa to not die over and over again. He needs to keep that ball rolling. He needs the tempo to be set to his pace and not to be sitting back on his laurels, because he's not a flash farmer. He doesn't do well from a deficit and trying to come back into the game. They just need that steamroller to keep on going. Is Nahas back?
Ah, I am back. Yes, thank you, my friend.
Excellent. But yeah, this is one of the first times I've seen.
Sorry, my headphones are picking a dump.
This is one of the first times I've seen RMN not play Witch Doctor. In the past, like, 5 or 6 games, I'm sure RMN has played Witch Doctor for Rox, but picking up the Oracle this time around. Sunstrike gives vision. Gonna see that there's no TPs out to these lanes. Give a little bit of intel there across the Team Spirit. Ramsey's down in the bottom lane. That's a little Ursa Bear. God Black plus always want to fly these two roaming and rotating potential supports. No boots on God Black, which we've seen him go for in the past, but I don't know.
Yeah. God Black, no stranger to early game aggression. And sorry about that. I have these wonderful wireless headphones that think turning themselves off is a lot of fun. But yeah, we got the Nyx Assassin that you were calling for. And I don't know. This is a really aggressive draft from Spirit. And I think Rox have a lot of tools to deal with them.
With Ghostix Time Walk, it doesn't purge things off. It just heals you up. So with the Fury Swipes from Ursa, the stacks are going to still stay. So if they can find themselves a position in this off lane where Ramses gets a few hits in, forces the Time Walk, and then they get the stun for Ramses to actually encroach and make up the distance, they could kill this Void on lane.
They can, but that better happen early on, because the minute this lineup from Roxkiss has any levels whatsoever, and even a couple of items, they just have so many tools to deal with the Ursa. It really does all boil down to that.
Bounty in a piece. No one's going to be sneaky. Begins. No one's being naughty. No one's stealing anything. Afterlife going for the more conventional, I guess more old school build here. The double Mango Stout Shield. No Iron Talon in sight for him just yet. But he does have 5 HP regen a second, which is honestly insane. Without using a Tango or anything like that. So surviving up here, it's going to be Tron. Playing your OD, RMN on that Oracle. Mid lane, Queen of Pain for BZZ. While Iceberg's Invoker are going to be supported a little bit by Always Wanna Fly's Earth Spirit, just sitting behind him. And the safe lane, dual lane, God Black plus Ramses is going to be dealing with a Lich Void off lane. This is disgusting.
It really is. I just like everything about Rox's lineup composition. Now, again, that's not necessarily telling. I said that in the last draft, and Empire lost the early game pretty handily. But, you know, on paper, I just really like this Rox's composition.
Oh, Afterlife. Oh, Afterlife.
Oh,
are you
don't
dead
do
here?
That. Don't do
One
that.
One final click, he's gone. They knew he didn't go for Carapace or Stun. They knew he went for the Mana Burn. They were certain they could get the kill, and they secured it in some fashion. Tron and RMN pairing up very nicely there. You know, without Arcane Orb, without Purifying Flames, just having Astral and Fortune's End to keep the Nyx at bay. And this is already going to be a difficult lane for Afterlife.
And boy, Yol might go down here too. Nice body block. Oh boy. The problem with Nyx too is he's not necessarily one of those Iron Talon junglers that can just have a fallback plan if the lane goes poorly. So you're stuck with Mana Burn at level 1. You're going to be getting zoned out here almost completely.
We've seen Mag do the Iron Talon a couple of times, and it's worked out okay. But I just think Mana Burn level 1 is really weird. It's working okay against RMN right here, trading hits with him, but the mana cost and the sort of intensivity of the spell feels kind of awkward when you could have a stun to try and steal last hits or something like that, but that's not his game plan for now. Iceberg.
So I am interested, so do you think it's the right call here shifting the Queen of... I thought that this was going to be a BZZ safe lane quap, and do you think it's the right call shifting her into the mid lane to get the matchup against Invoker? They obviously did not... They obviously agree with what you were saying early in the draft, that the OD Invoker matchup is not that favorable.
I'm not entirely sure. I guess the Queen of Pain is less susceptible to being roamed on by Earth Spirit, especially, but also in addition to the Venge. We're just going to watch Yol cut himself through the trees and now walk straight back into Always Wanna Fly. There's no gap. There's nowhere to run. There is no pathing here. Your pathing god is dead. Oh, the roaming onto mid. There's Afterlife faking out the stun. But yeah, I think it's just the fact that BZZ is not likely to die mid, whereas the OD could.
Oh god, man, he is really lucky. BZZ is actually really lucky there that Mana Burn still had 3 seconds on cooldown when Afterlife walked up around the ramp there, because if he gets Mana Burn off there, BZZ does not have enough mana to blink.
Doesn't have mana to blink right now, but this Obs Ward's going to spot out Afterlife's every movements. BZZ's going to come in and hit him a couple of times, punch him. Afterlife, he's got Stout Shield, 5.1 HP regen, he doesn't care. He is well happy trading hits with his Queen of Pain mid just to give Iceberg that little bit of advantage that we were kind of looking for. While Ramsey's the bottom lane, this Ursa's not having the best of times. You compare his CS with the ODs, 20-10, 13-1. It's a little bit disparate there between the two of them because Tron is a free lane. He is alone on this top lane, while our men can stack and pull and just wander around doing whatever he wants.
Yeah, but when you compare the fact that the OD has been living in a totally uncontested lane and the Ursa has a hero kill right now, the disparity is certainly not what it could be.
Joystick. He's got the ice armor on him. Ramses does not like this one bit. Oh, there's a kill on mid lane as the Nyx gets taken out.
And that's the root from the Oracle, and that's just so disastrous. Afterlife feeling that the best use of his time, and he's probably right, is to contest the Fiend of Pain mid.
Because, is Ramses dead?
Oh, boy.
One bash. They're going to get it. Ghost
is just disaster for Spirit. I know the kill score is close, guys, but this is exactly what they did not want to happen in the early game.
This Lich pick definitely threw a spanner in the works and always want to fly. We're seeing the same story again. This Earth Spirit feels, in some respects, a lot like that kind of roaming support bounty hunter we used to see, where in the early stages, if you don't get to that level 3 mark, you're in trouble.
That is a nasty early Earth Spirit combo right there. And a good call by Yol just to say goodbye.
Yeah, see ya, buddies. Ghost sticks out as well. All of these resources piled into the bottom lane. Earth Spirit and Venge not roaming mid, not helping Iceberg. Now we're looking at this Oracle and Queen of Pain looking to maybe try and slow his farm rate. But Iceberg, 21-15, he's crushing this Queen of Pain in terms of CS with the help of that Nyx Assassin coming across. But it does leave Nyx at level 2.5. Now trying to deal with these jungle creeps. I mean, okay, you've got Quelling Blade. Doesn't make it really that much easier. And RMN just biding his time, waiting for that moment to strike.
He needs Iceberg to be just a little bit lower here.
They're going to go now. Scream initiation. Yeah. There's Iceberg. Fairy fires up. He's healing himself through with a Quasp, but it's not enough. BZZ will find the kill.
Good patience. He knew exactly. That's good coordination by the two teammates there. Knew exactly how much damage their spell combo did with a couple right clicks. They knew Invoker had the Fairy Fire, and that's just really good planning by him to wait until Invoker gets harassed down by Shadow Strike.
Meanwhile, in top lane land, OD, 37-26. I don't even know if he needs all these denies, but he's just padding out his stats. He wants himself to be up on Dat Dota, to be in Nahaz's spreadsheets.
There you go, baby.
Up at the top at number one.
That's what we're talking about. The numbers. The numbers don't lie.
The numbers don't lie, but it's great.
Well, actually, we have Sir Action Slacks doing stats now. They probably do. I mean, but anyway, RMN going to get initiated on here.
You call them stats. He posts memes in the little stat boxes.
It's true.
That's what he does, stat memes.
Memes that occasionally feature numbers.
Yep. RMN, he's likely dead here. More than likely. That's a good sun strike.
And that actually is huge that they figure out a way to give that kill to Iceberg.
Without him leaving the lane as well, yeah.
Right.
Oh, Goblack chased down. BZZ Shadow Strikes there, y'all. That's a nice little sentry. Goblack's not going to get dropped, and they also find the D ward. Goblack, great awareness. Seeing that Lich come across, puts himself in harm's way, but still gets the D ward out while Ramses are bottom lane. This is where he starts to fully bully Ghosting. Just look at that damage. He misses out on the clap, which maybe could have secured a kill. But Yol's Lich, limited mana, always want to fly, same kind of story. Everyone running around with no mana pool to deal with.
You cannot, oh my goodness, with all that OD is getting up here, you can't just go ahead and give him a kill as well. I was just getting ready to say that the Spirit cores were having a better time in this game despite the contested lane bot, but the OD kill just nullifies so much of that progress, and you're going to get a kill onto Ursa here too.
Oh, they're taking him out. BZZ, good rotation. Doesn't even expend a Sonic Wave. And with a 2-1-2-1 build, he's still ready to go and kill someone off again if they want to find the Earth Spirit. Always want to fly. It's not in vision.
And that's about as big a turnaround as you can have at 7 minutes there for Rox, those two kills. The laning phase is just kind of out of control now for Spirit. I mean, you know, Iceberg is going to have a decent timing on his Midas, but the cores of Rox are just going to be so far ahead.
And a 7.5 minute Nyx Assassin Iron Talon. This is why I kind of wanted him to go for the Iron Talon as straight as he possibly could, because the Mangoes and Stab Shield, if they don't ensure you a good laning stage and good experience gain, they are worthless to you. Because those, roll into mid with a kick as well. Sunstrike, good. BZZ taken out of the game. Oh, he blinks himself back with the help of the bottle. Also holding onto the Fairy Fire, but those stick charges working out wonders. Once again, Team Spirit just inches away from grabbing themselves a juicy kill. But yeah, Nyx Assassin, if the Stout Shield, Double Mango don't ensure you levels on the offlane, that was a waste of gold, in my mind.
Yes. Yeah, I think that that's right as far as it worked out. This is, again, though, Rocks are just are getting these big kills onto Team Spirit Heroes when they absolutely have to have them. Invoker is able, Iceberg is able to buy out for his Midas there, so it's not that big a loss, but boy, oh boy. They're going to have to find a way to stop the bleeding here. They really are.
OD drums, treads, 9 minutes.
Yeah, it's just such a good call. For the same reason that Urn Drum was a good call for Spectre in our last match, I feel like the drum treads is such a good call for OD here. He's just ready to fight.
And the thing is, I was saying how Enrage for Ursa, it's gonna be great. I said it was going to be amazing against OD and Queen
of
Pain.
Until he pops Enrage and immediately gets imprisoned for the duration.
Yeah. but not just that. You look at the OD, he's level 8. He's got this level 3 orb. And Enrage, it's 80% damage reduction, right? But OD still deals out a shit ton more damage. I don't think Ramsey's going to be able to do that man mode, jump in, and find these kills, especially when he's so far away from Blink Dagger. I mean, he's looking for a Morbid Mask at 9 minutes. His farm rate has been completely subdued. And
yeah.
Just think of the Cubs. They're hungry.
It's just I'm a Cardinal baseball fan. I don't Radiant's think of the Cubs, especially when they're losing. Attack. But anyway,
I don't get that reference. Point. But haha.
I understand Europeans. Haha.
Euros. Shake my head.
The problem is though, as we talked about early on, this Ursa, he needed to get ahead. He needed to be online. He needed to be taking Roche before all of the tools that Rocks have to deal with him come online. And that's just not happened at all in this game. Another aggressive smoke here is going to be a kill, at least on the Goblack.
Ball is going to fly. He tries his best Superman impression, rolls himself out, but the two supports are goners here. And this is going to transition nicely into a tier one. So not only did Team Spirit get themselves a grasp on the map, it's OD. What's he waiting for? Is he looking for a kill onto Iceberg? Well, TP in with the Astral there, Oracle. He'll set up, kill off the Forge Spirits. Fortune's End is ready, and Iceberg, you've got no points in Wex. He'll try and ice wall himself out of this one. The Cold Snap is good, but Tron just has too much damage. Through the Sanity's Eclipse, they'll clear him up, and Iceberg's laning stage has been demolished.
Yep, unfortunately, it's just what happens when Roxkiss are just getting exactly the kills that they need to at the right times. It's so the way the XP comeback mechanics work, it doesn't matter if you get this huge lead in lane if you then get killed a couple of times. It just nullifies that advantage so quickly.
Ramses, he's going for Roche, but Yol, Chainfrost is out and Ramses is dead. Yol finds the solo kill and Roshan's not even taken yet. They'll find the next one on Afterlife as the BZZ Queen of Pain blinks on forward. And poor little Nyx Assassin only has an Iron Talon and a Wand. With this Roshan on such low HP.
You could see poor Ursa there as he was doing Roshan, just come on, don't sniff me out. He actually popped his ulti a little earlier than you otherwise would optimally, just to try and get that extra damage before he knew Roxicus were going to show up there.
3,000 net worth on this Ursa. Well, that's about half of what the Outworld Devourer has as he heads into that Rod of Atos. Again, another item that's going to be great against this Ursa, who hates being kited, who hates being slowed down. That cripple effect, it's not going to be too friendly for him.
The Vlads is up on the Void just so early on. You compare it to how poor Havosh was in our last match. Void, these utility items that are the build nowadays on him are just so effective when you get him up at this timing.
Hey, just look at his net worth. He's actually second. 4,900. He's pretty much got as much farm as a safe lane carry in a regular game would. You know, not talking free farm. He's done very well for himself. 2-0-2, 54 last hits by 12 minutes. It's more than reasonable, more than satisfactory. It's pretty damn good.
That's understating the case by quite a bit. Even the Queen of Pain that had a Nyx Assassin interface for most of the laning stage is sitting there with a 500 lead on the Invoker.
She's got 5 kills. That definitely helps out.
Yes, she's played well, but and not only are they kills, but I don't know. I'm gonna stop repeating myself. I promise, guys. I'm sorry, but they just have gotten the kills on Spirit's Heroes exactly when they needed to get them to set back their lineup. Yikes.
Then you just take a peek at this Oracle. 2,700 net worth. He's got a buckler, as well as what looks like the makings of an Aether Lens. Did you see which order he picked these up in, actually? Like, is he going?
I did not.
I wonder if he's going to go mech first and then Aether Lens, or Aether first and then mech. Well, either way, we'll find out in a bit, I guess. But Tranquil Boots, no arcanes for RMN. They do mosey on into this Radiant jungle. Radiant's being spotted out by a good defensive ward here, though. Dire's top tower. Always want to fly, sets up on mid. He's finally hit that level 6. He kicked, but he misses.
Oh, no.
EZZ was a step ahead.
Yeah, just Spirit desperately trying to get some sort of trade out of that. And they're not going to. I don't think they can take this tier 1 mid, not even close.
They're trying for the top 1.
I'm not even sure they can stop the tier 2 push if Rox decides to go in that direction. Oh, this is a really nice smoke.
I thought they might be able to TP top and stop the Ursa taking the tier 1 up at the top lane.
Why? I mean, yes, you can, but your time is better used being aggressive, taking over that bottom right quadrant of the map. What have we
here? Finish off the Rod of Eidos for Tron's OD. Tron TP's towards the tier 1 mid. These Ancients have been taken out by Iceberg, the one safe place that he can farm. But this Chrono, Ghostick is just ready and prepped for this movement in. If only they had high ground vision, the smoke will pop and God Black will be spotted. Always want to fly, rolls himself away, but Iceberg found himself a route of victory here to get himself back to base. Just look at that. TP's the fountain on full HP, full mana. That's how paranoid they are.
Exactly. And that's the benefit of this strategic decision by Rox to continue pressuring the Radiant side of the map. I really like that. You don't... Again, there's no impetus right now to secure your jungle when you're already this far ahead. I mean, great. Let Ursa do his thing by himself when your whole team is taking over their side of the map.
Chill, guys. Ursa's doing a battle pass quest.
Oh, God. Like, the map. Okay. Mask of Madness. Yeah. Wow.
Did you have all the people in your pubs where everyone was spamming Ember Spirit and being absolutely trash? Oh, always want to fly. See you, buddy. Did you have a ton of Ember Spirit spammers being super trash at the hero in your pubs for like a week and a half?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. I
played one Ember game and I finished the quest and I was like, oh, that was easy. And then a bunch of my mates are like, this is so hard. This is so hard. All these Ember freaking pickers just doing nothing in the game whatsoever apart from trying to get these slight chains on people.
Not to get too far off topic on this, but I actually thought you put it really well. I forget who you were explaining it to, but the way you put it was Ember is a really hard hero if you don't have the concept in your head about how to play him. That you have to basically ignore the jungle and just farm your face off in lane. And I thought that was a really good explanation. Well, Ursa here better not get caught in this dire jungle. He's really doing the only thing left that he can to be productive with his time, but he's still at a lot of risk here.
If only they could integrate... Did you hear Seraction Slax's idea for the Aghanim's upgrade for Ursa?
I try not to listen to those, but go ahead.
Okay, so basically what it was, he wants to remove the Ags upgrade that he has
here's
now.
Here's a Chrono, by the way, always want to fly. His time in this world is just about up.
Ceases to exist. Double ulti used for him. But yeah, Slax's idea for Ags upgrade for Ursa was that he goes into a jungle, he makes a den where he can hibernate inside. He comes back, he's stronger, he's hungry. He didn't figure out what hungry meant, but it gives him some kind of buff. But this den has cubs inside, and the cubs stack the camps for you.
Like, the funny thing is, I love Jake. He's one of my favorite people. But you listen to these ideas, and individually they're funny. And then you think about it and realize that if more than two of them were implemented, Dota would just be completely unplayable.
This is a good initiation. If Afterlife can land it, two-man stun down and out. And this is Iceberg's chance to shine, but the Chain Frost bounces between them. Ramses can't find initiation. The Ash will be all he has, but Tron, no Aegis left. He's got no Aegis. Tron is dropping low, and I think he might just be able to die here. He turns the fight with the Eclipse down. He takes down one. The Ursa's gone, but the OD does drop. Tornado.RoX still looking for a way back into this fight. As BZZ blinked aggressively in, drawing three of them off to the side while always want to fly. He wanted the other kills. The two-man stun back onto RMN and Yol. We'll catch him, but it's Goblack. He wants blood from BZZ, and this is a fight that RoX really shouldn't have been involved in. It was all down to Afterlife. Great initiation with that impale.
Yeah, at the end of the day, Team Spirit get an even trade, which is just a huge victory for them in that situation. There's no reason, given the state that the game was in it. Oh, the kill on the Queen of Raid! Oh my, Iceberg. I'm just going to sit here and enjoy that for a minute.
I missed it. I missed it. I was about to pan my camera down.
You're an Invoker player. You can't miss that kill.
But I didn't know. Oh. If only we could rewind and go back and watch it.
I love you, dude, but I'm disappointed in you.
Oh, dear me. Iceberg. Making a name for himself. 4,300 gold. This invoker has gone from like dog shit laning stage where he's just being crushed by Tornado.RoX to having more money than God. What did he buy? He's buying his flags. Flags.
He had a great laning phase because it was secured by the Nyx Assassin, and then he gave the couple of big kills up, and it looked like he was just going to be really out of the game. But a couple of big fights from him, and he's just. He can do whatever he wants. Casual 18-minute drums, eggs, Midas in a game that your team was getting crushed in. Sure, why not? God. I'm telling you, this could be a really, really good player. If this team stays stable and they get the right people around him, he's got quite a bit of upside, in my opinion.
What did that do for the swing? Rox of themselves a 10k net worth lead at one point. It's been dipped a little bit by Team Spirit. But it's still these items on the Ursa that are missing. He's got the Blink Dagger now, so initiation is there. Next Roshan is going to be imperative for Team Spirit to pick up. And it's not even about consolidating your lead. It's not necessarily about coming back into the game. It's just bolstering your forces and being able to fight with that Aegis on Ursa. But they're going to fight without it anyway between Earth Spirit and this little bear. They try the kick, but guess is wrong. And Tron, with a little shimmy, jukes himself around the boulder, gets himself to safety, and now heading into a BKB. This OD is not going to care about a single thing that Team Spirit throws at him.
Yeah, you still have the possibility of a really good swap, but again, if he's quick on the trigger with his Imprison, that's not going to matter either. I mean, I feel like we talk about how Ursa gets so hard countered and so kited by so many of the skills and abilities that Rox is going to have on the table, but there's still, you know, it's a five-man game for a reason, and you count on your teammates to pick you up with great initiation, similarly to what happened in that fight top.
Tornado.RoX, what are you planning here? Earth Spirit, he made a move towards top rune, and I thought that would be the target that they go for. But with limited vision, going for a smoke like this is, you know, it's risky. You've got no idea where the rest of Team Spirit are, and Rox, they now know that Nyx is bot lane with limited mana, Vendetta on cooldown for a little bit. Question is, can they catch him with a Sunstrike? Where did that go? Don't know where the Sunstrike went, but Iceberg was scouting for something, and they're going to miss out on the Nyx, or are they? They've got wind of him, and Afterlife, he's got Vendetta, they have Dust, they've got Sentries, they've got Reveal. Nyx Assassin's dead.
Dire's middle tower is under attack. Fine. At the end of the day, that's still a smoke and a four-hero rotation for one offlaner kill. And that's Dire's actually completely fine. Is under attack. Now, what's not fine is if Iceberg gets caught out here, because he has more than enough time to see this coming.
He even pops the drums to secure his retreat. Still needs some kind of mobility item. You know, the Blink Dagger is usually what you go for before the Aghanim Scepter. Iceberg can always go back into that. 2,000 gold saved up. All the other option is you go for the Boots of Travel, and you go for that kind of split bush route. You shove down a lane with your Forge Spirits. TP into a team fight. Just gotta make sure you don't get caught out by these guys, because you are gonna be dealing with a Queen of Pain Orchid very soon. I'm a little bit interested about BZZ's item progression here, because treads into Yules, fair enough. You're dealing with a lot of annoying heroes, the Silence from Earth Spirit, the jump in and the stuns out from Nyx Assassin are very annoying. Going back into the Orchid though.
I actually really, by the way, agree with this item progression here from Iceberg. He's actually even gonna go into the Boots of Travel before the Blink Dagger. And I think that's absolutely right to sit here for the same reasons that we've been talking about Rox having so many tools to deal with the Ursa, that you blink in and they have so many ways to disrupt your combo.
I was meant to Afterlife. That was ballsy, buddy. Gets the Vendetta and makes his move away from that one, but it's a push off the tier 2 at top. Iceberg with the double Forge Spritz making short work of this tower, while Tornado.RoX setting up for this. The kick onto Tron. And the rest of Spirit here behind him, they don't want to initiate into Aegis. Just want to make sure that Iceberg... Well, I was going to say make sure Iceberg gets away, but he wants to do more damage to this tower, apparently. The rest of Rox, they are incoming. Cavalry is awaiting. But Team Spirit have this all timed perfectly. TP back down, push bot lane, and you're just dragging Rox from pillar to post across this map. It's like a game of badminton or a game of tennis. You know, you're shoving them across the court and making sure that they don't get that slam dunk. They don't get that one play that wins them the game.
No, that's exactly right. And I was thinking exactly the same thing before you made that point, that what a difference 7-8 minutes makes. Not so long ago in this game, Rox were the ones that were dictating tempo and dictating pace. They were forcing action on the enemy side of the map. And now it just feels like they're getting led around.
The line on the map is drawn. The table is set. They want to keep mid and top pushed out, it looks like. There's a tier 2 at bottom lane, which they could relatively easily go for, but they know that as soon as they TP bot to defend tier 1 here, Iceberg's going to TP to another lane. So I just wonder if they do the old Tinker move, and they smoke themselves up, bait out one lane with, you know, someone like the Faceless Void, pretend that he's there with someone behind him. And then they go and smoke into another lane as Yol is caught, Sunstrike is good, and Lich is dead.
That's fine. So my question to you is, where does Ursa go with this gold that he's got? Oh my, nice initiation here on the OD, who's going to BKB up and just destroy them!
Ramzes is in trouble as well! They were the ones that wanted to initiate into them. Ghosting. Oh, the Chrono. He's landed it. Tron, does he have the range to attack into it? He does indeed. The Ghostwalk is here for Iceberg, and he gets it off just in time. Invis through, kick across, and Iceberg looks like he's out and pretty happy with that one. He invoked Ghostwalk before the Chrono landed. All he had to do was spam that button.
Wow. That was still a disaster, but it wasn't an act of God. Because that could have been absolutely devastating for Spirit. I don't know if they just didn't realize that the OD had his BKB up. I mean, the OD had Aegis to begin with. That's what makes no sense to me about that fight.
Yeah, they're jumping into an OD who likely has an Oracle behind him. It's going to save him one way or another. BKB and Aegis, there are like four ways that Tron gets out of that situation with his life.
And boy, that really... Ursa, okay, so Ursa does decide to go... He was holding on to a lot of gold there, and he does decide to just go for the Blink Dagger, all right.
He had that Blink a while back.
Oh, he did? Okay, he's had that Blink still. Blink Mask of Madness. It's. I still am not used to some of these new meta builds that we're seeing.
But you were asking where he goes next, and honestly, he desperately needs a BKB, but he also, it's again one of those situations where he needs so many items that making the decision to go for one first is the toughest decision to make. Fallen. Even if you have 5,000 gold, deciding do I go BKB, do I go Basher, do I go this, do I go that, what do I do here? Dealing with the orbs out from Tron though, you desperately need some kind of magic immunity. The Astral's there, Swap's not thrown out. Biding that time, it's Aegis OD is just going to turn and fight them with the Orchid onto the Venge. They'll clear up God Black easily with Ghosting jumping in, not having the Chronosphere. He baits out the Meteor, and Tron just keeps on battling on through it. Ramzes finds his target, jumps on him, but Tron is kept alive, held in place with the Deafening Blast, but they've just taken one after the other, and Iceberg Astral to cancel his TP. Tornado Rox have this game on lockdown.
Yeah, they just have no answer for the BKB on OD right now, especially with Ursa as far behind as he is. That's kind of, you know, it's great in theory to have that Mask of Madness Blink build because you ulti while you're Berserk and it nullifies the increased damage. But, you know, the Mask of Madness duration is 12 seconds and the ulti your ulti duration is only 4. And especially when Rox has so many control options.
I never thought about this interaction before. Void plus Oracle. You purifying flames, you time walk, you purifying flames, you time walk off the damage that's dealt, and you are, look at that, it's, RMN! Okay, now it's RMN that wants to be on that Dota for most heal done to frickin' Ghostick, honestly. Insane kick forward, but Afterlife doesn't have a route in, the Aegis is down for Tron, so they do not have that secondary life up available for him. So Tornado.RoX will back themselves away from this. I don't think Team Spirit wants to let them go with a good kick. Again, catching two. Goblack with a swap back. Tron has been caught, but he pops his BKB, turns to fight, and Goblack is screwed under the Chain Frost as well. And Chrono down for Always Wanna Fly secures that one up. Easy peasy. But Team Spirit.
Now that you mentioned that interaction, we still got to fight.
Oh, man. Ramzes not done. Meteor Deafening Blast is not on the money. And this damage output from Rox just keeps on coming. BZZ takes one out with a Purifying Flames from RMN. They look to Fortune's End Iceberg. And this EMP, it might deter Rox, and it will. Force them back away from this, but Ramzes Afterlife jump in again. They want this third fight to go their way. They get a kill on a support, but that's about it. Maybe they can catch RMN, but the sentry's down. BZZ yules up into the air onto the Nyx Assassin, and Afterlife throws the stun to cancel the TP of RMN. Good awareness from the Nyx Assassin, but this might be his downfall as Ghosting flicks him with a time dilation. Ice Wall is out, but so are Tornado.RoX.
It looked like, and he definitely did miss some spells in that fight, but I actually think Iceberg used his spells pretty well considering the situation that his team is in. That could have been disastrous for Spirit and wasn't. But as far as the Oracle Void interaction, it's one of those awkward things, because you said it, I feel like I knew about that only because a certain smart person that I talked to told me about it, and then was like, oh wait, don't say anything about it if you cast a game. I'm like, okay. That's one of those, pretty damn awkward.
One of those niche little things that, you know, it's always like that. You find an interaction that not everyone knows about, and you keep it hidden, you keep it secret.
Well, it was one of those things. Actually, the same thing happened the last game that we had with the interaction between Winter Wyvern and Auras, in with Winter Wyvern countering Auras pretty heavily. I was careful not to talk about that, but then I heard a caster talk about it in the game the other day, so I was like, all right, cool, I can say that. It's out there.
People work things out for themselves sometimes.
I don't know. It part of the fun for me being the old man is talking to some of these players. The players that we have are just really very, very clever right now. They come up with all these little interactions that I certainly would never have thought of.
At this point, Tron making great strides towards Hex, I guess, looking at the way this game's going. The BKB is up for Ramzes. Oh, mid lane, who's been caught out here? BGZ will blink himself over the head of Afterlife. Was that a pink ping or was that a purple ping? I'm not sure who saw who. I don't know if Afterlife was being told to get back or if Tornado.RoX knew that Afterlife was there because the courier was floating Dyer's overhead. Either way it goes, it's a Shiver's Guard for OD, not the Hex.
Dyer's top tower has
That's
fallen.
An interesting choice.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. You already have so many tools to deal with the Ursa that the marginal value of getting one more is a lot less than it otherwise would be. And it's a kiting tool. I mean, Shivas is a kiting tool just the same.
Keep on chasing people down. Go black. You are farming creeps in a very dangerous position, and you might just die for it.
Yeah. Atos OP, man.
The range on Atos is insane.
1200 range. That is no joke. That is the one most underrated thing about that item, and one of the more underrated aspects of any item in the game is just the sheer initiation range.
I was playing Scarath mid the other day, or a couple of weeks ago, it must have been like a week ago or something for my daily challenge. And I play mid, so I played Scarath mid, and it was fine. It was fun. I built Aether Lens and Rod of Atos, and it drove me insane at how long range I could initiate from. Yes. Because I would initiate from further range than I could actually cast any other spells. It's like, right, I've got this Rod of Atos, I've started on someone, but I can't catch up to them and follow through because the range of my other spells isn't good enough.
I actually, it's funny because you brought him up, but I actually think Skywrath might be back, at least a little bit, just because of how well so many of the meta heroes set up with him.
Oh, Ramzes, he's got his number of BZZ, he's being shredded, but he blinks himself away with a BKB up. The blink aggressively from Ramzes, trying to chase him down, but he guessed incorrectly. Well, Ghost Stick is busy taking down Roshan, so Invoker and Nyx both die, Invoker down in bottom lane. But it's OD that's going to take up this Aegis, and they've got cheese as well for the face of Void, or even to pop it over to the Queen of Pain if she wants it.
Yeah, and this is the Aegis on OD is just a really big deal for them right now. Because he's a hero that can be a bit of a glass cannon, but with the Shivas and the BKB and the Atos already up, killing him twice starts to become really scary. Of course meanwhile, while you're getting that objective, you're draining resources from Spirit. Yeah, exactly. At what you just said.
What was Ursa doing over there? Well, regardless, Ramzes does die.
What have we here?
And gives away a fair amount of gold over to Tornado.RoX. It's worrying stuff. I mean, it's, again, another one of those situations where Ursa feels the need to go and farm away from... Oh, God Black. That's the use of BZZ to set up and start things off. It's a tanky Venge and might not die to this as BZZ's forced to BKB and Iceberg. With always on a flyer, they actually... close the net, down into BZZ, and with that blink forward, Afterlife gets a ton of damage, but the Sunstrike won't be on the mark, and neither will the stun. The False Promise out from RMN will keep him up and running. A good Meteor Deafening Blast, though, pushes back three, and this maybe is where Iceberg can really start to shine, but the BKB from Tron keeps him alive and happy. Except this cold snap on RMN.
RMN?
He's okay. It's fine, but who's not fine? Ghostic, EMP, dead, gone. Tornado will secure the kill, it looks like, and finish him off. As over to the side, it's just fights and little mini battles everywhere. The Nyx Assassin, offlaner for offlaner. Oh, God. Well, and then another one? And another one?
As Iceberg, don't you have to... I mean, you have to be so frustrated with that play. That False Promise by RMN literally the split second before the Sunstrike hit.
Yeah. Fortune's End, False Promise. Stop people in their tracks, keep people alive. Yeah. No, Fortune's End's the stun, the ensnare.
Okay, good, good. I still have this little part of me. I was pretty sure I had the right
No, you had it right. But... Oh, it's just that he threw Fortune's End out initially in the start of the team fight and held people in place for OD to actually kind of weasel himself out of the situation, and then the False Promise to keep him alive through the Sunstrike as well. It's all just so great from RMN.
And after all that, OD still has his Aegis up, right?
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Just no missed beat here.
You know, it's nice seeing RMN on these like tier two teams, I guess. But you know, the higher echelon of the tier two teams, because we used to see him on Goomba Gaming, the German squad. He played a bit for Power Rangers as a stand-in, but now he seems relatively settled in Tornado.RoX. I don't know if he's going to be a permanent fixture. Middle tower is under attack. He's looking good.
No, I'm really pleased with the way that he's made the transition to support play. I used to think of him primarily as a mid player. He's played some very nice Invoker games that I've seen, but I really like. He's provided a lot of stability to this team, and that's not easy because these are all high octane players.
My thanks. Is this the high ground push they were looking for? Aegis on OD still available. He is not the best hero to just walk up onto high ground and hit away at buildings, but if there's no tier 3 there, who cares? You can do it anyway. Forge Spirits do not last long under the burning power of the Arcane Orb.
He's not the best in a vacuum, but again, with this build, he becomes so much more in your face than he otherwise would be.
Where's Team Spirit? Invoker is mid. He can BOT himself into this fight and pop his Forge, get himself into the Tornado Meteor, but racks are falling and with no Glyph available. Invoker is still waiting his time to actually go and initiate on this team fight. Yeah, Iceberg doesn't want a part of it. He's just taking tier 2. And here we go. The Chrono down to 3. Ghosting has found him with the Sonic Wave out, and they're all freaking dead. Tron just drops the hammer. And with a triple kill straight out like that, you've got to wonder if Iceberg's not joining, the rest of your team sit in the bloody fountain.
Yeah, I'm not so sure that the tier 2 for Rax trade is going to catch on in the meta. Ay-yay-yay.
No buybacks available either for any of them. Iceberg's trying his damnedest to get this tier 3 up at top lane. He'll take it down and look for the Rax. He's going to blink himself back as Ghostick is not a man to be trifled with. Still does a lot of damage, and with that time warp, he can keep himself going and chasing on this Invoker for extended periods of time. So Tornado.RoX just take another lane of Rax. BZZ, BKB, all popped up and ready. Is Afterlife. There's the Tornado 1-1, but Afterlife starts up, can't get anything out, and the Meteor Deafening Blast, again, not on the money. While Tron just sits high ground and wails on into Iceberg's Invoker, there's no reveal out just yet as he popped his Ghost Fork, but this False Promise keeping Tron alive for now. He'll probably die to the Sunstrike as well, but he's still got that Aegis and BKB. He heals up.
Oh my lord.
I thought he'd die. Afterlife gets turned on, and that BKB kept him alive. Tron, he can potentially just keep on fighting here if he wants to. With the help of BZZ, he gets swapped. He has no choice. He has to fight now. And Iceberg looks for the kill on Quap, but the Queen of Pain can blink away, gets herself into the trees. Ramsey's just waiting with a bash, hit, and kill. Finally getting something for their worries. But Tron, caught by the Tornado.
Look at the range with this combo.
Aegis is gone. Astral is there, but guess who's back, baby? Oh. Ghostick with the Chrono onto 3, and Tron, perfect position to get that kill on the Invoker. Ramses gets in, no bash just yet. Iceberg buys back, Deafening Blast forward as Tron, they'll finally kill him at long, long last. The 16-1-8. Invoker not getting the last hit. Ramses gets 1400 gold, but not before the OD kills off the Earth Spirit.
I mean, how big are Iceberg's shoulders after that fight? Because he has just taken his whole team on his back and said, all right, guys, we're losing. We're probably not going to win this match anyway, but I'm going to give us a chance. That's crazy.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack. Iceberg still has 4,500 gold, interestingly enough, after dying and buying back. I guess after the BKB. Look for. I'm pretty sure you look for refresher here. You skip the Octarine, you go refresher because that's your game-winning item, right? That's the swinger.
Seriously?
Yeah.
All right, I'm down, man. If you think you can pull it off, I am utterly down.
Like with double BKB, double Meteor Deafening Blast, the BKBs of Dire are wearing down. Like you got 5 seconds on OD. Just being able to get that damage output into a short period of time. The other item for me would be Hex, but I don't think.
No,
that's going to be lackluster for me. I think it has to be refresher.
No, it's one of those two, I think, for sure. But I just. That refresher is a YOLO play, I think.
Oh yeah, I think they have to.
I agree.
I mean, they've...
Although, you know what, I don't know. They've made so much happen here in the last couple of minutes. They've now traded evenly on Raxes.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack. With the OD dead, and with this OD alive, I think the bull rush down this top lane to kind of equalize things out, because it's naked Rax again up on top. If Tornado.RoX can really reset these lanes across the river and push top aggressively, and Team Spirit, they've got to be the ones that do something. 5,500 gold saved up on Iceberg, and honestly, he doesn't have buyback for 5 minutes. So there's no point in saving up for anything. I mean, there's no point in saving up for buyback. Just go for that big ticket item.
Yeah, more and more I think I'm with you on this, man. It's one of those that... Aww. You got us back into the game. He is going to go Octarine. It is the safer choice. At some point, the issue that I have evaluating some of these games is you've got to figure out, okay, when have we done enough to shift out of desperation mode and start building items that aren't just all in place?
Oh. You can still go for Refresher as his sixth slot. I really wanted an Iceberg.
I really did too. The Invoker fanboy in me was dying to see it, but I think the Octarine is the smarter choice.
Like, as an Invoker, you never want to go BKB, so that's like one item slot already kind of wasted in the eyes of an Invoker picker. You never want to go BKB, but sometimes you just have to.
Yeah, there is absolutely... You basically... The blink has very little value without the BKB, honestly. Yeah. Because you blink in, and they have so many ways to just lock you down if you don't have it.
Oh, Ramses is pretty close to Abyssal Blade, but he does still need to keep this money for buyback. Afterlife keeping an eye out, making sure that his buddy doesn't get found.
Oh, this,
but
you
the
just
blink
can't
forward.
Do this here. Ah.
Ramses, it's tragic. I think Afterlife is dead as well. No buyback on your Nyx. And this Ursa Bear, he's going to have to buyback to defend top racks. Tornado.RoX, like I said, they just reset the lanes, mid lane across the river pretty much. Bot lane has to be shoved by Iceberg. But this is where, you know, the bulldozer just goes down and takes these buildings out. There is a glyph for the Radiant, but I don't know how useful that's going to be.
Now this is where what you said about having the naked Rax top is so devastating that if you don't give up that kill on Ursa there, you can probably at least keep the lane equilibrium decent. But now it's going to cost you at least a buyback, and they don't have to back here.
All we're waiting for is Ghostick's move. Spirit have to be so wary of his jump in. Well, there's the little blink, the little fake out there. Iceberg not going to fake out anything with a Tornado Meteor. Chrono onto the Invoker, but the swap back from Godblack keeps Iceberg alive. Tron BKBs through and always want to fly. He's going to die. Again, a swap. What? Ghoststick jumped himself away, but BZZ trying to right-click through as Iceberg BKBs himself. Turns to battle, but he's got nothing left. With no Tornado Meteor, his combos are waning, and a deafening blast will give them some space and time, but Ramses cycloned up. Can't keep himself on the tail of the OD with BZZ able to blink away. The force staff is there and he gets himself out barely on a beasting of health. But whoa, Tron, hello, what are you doing, Astral himself? He's in the thick of things, but he looks like he's going to be okay. Healed up and kept alive by RMN to godlike plays on the Oracle and GG. Spirit tap out.
I mean, Iceberg just did everything he could to basically win this game by himself, but the execution from Rox, almost from beginning to end in this game, was certainly the best that we've seen yet today. They had a great game plan. They had a great set of almost hard counters to the Ursa, and you saw it. I mean, a 5-10 Ursa that just really struggled from start to finish in this match. This is a very, very nicely executed game by Rox. I agree with what you said by RMN, about RMN on his support play. It's a very nice team.
For sure. Well, one more game for CIS region, one more game for me and Nahaz, as we head ourselves straight on in. Another Spirit game. They're taking on Hellraisers in a couple of minutes, guys. So go grab yourselves a snack, a drink, take a little break, and come back for Spirit against Hellraisers in a couple of minutes.